I'm Blake Gex, and this is another Nuclear Reaction. Genuine reviews and breakdowns of metal, rock, and beyond. So, it's been too long since I've tapped into the infinite list and checked out a request from there. So, it's about time I reacted to Slipknot again. And I'm going to be checking out the song Custer, requested by Nicholas LeMay, Broken Luis, and Slave Foe. Now, let me be clear with you guys. I have had this song played for me by someone years ago. So, technically, I have heard it play in the background before. That being said, I don't remember anything about it, except that there was like some kind of siren sound in the song, something like that, some kind of ringing or siren, unless I'm thinking of Pulse of the Maggots, I don't know. But there was something, like some kind of element in the song. That's all I really remember. Otherwise, I would call this a review, but because I actually don't have much of an idea of how this will sound, it really is just going to be me reacting to it. And so for those wondering why I, as a metalhead, have not heard so many songs by Slipknot, here's how it works. Slipknot was one of the first metal bands that I ever heard back in like 2004 when I was a teenager, like when I was first getting into metal. And I have heard the first three albums quite often, especially in my younger years. But I became sort of close-minded for a few years afterward. So basically anything after volume three, it's going to be new to me, unless I've reacted to it on this channel already. And by the way, there's a Slipknot playlist of all my reactions so far if you want to check that out. As for the close-minded thing, I definitely am not that way anymore. And I'm open to any music, and there are plenty more Metalhead Reacts videos coming up as well, so you can look forward to that if that's something you're into. And I guess that it was sort of a good thing in disguise that I went through that sort of close-minded phase years ago, because little did I know I'd eventually start a reaction channel. So yeah, I've heard this played by someone else once, possibly twice. I don't remember much of anything about it. I only know that it's been played because of the song name. That's the only thing that's familiar to me. So I'm going to check it out. Slipknot is a band where I like some songs, I love a few songs, and I don't always necessarily like everything by them. I don't consider myself like a maggot. But there is some stuff by them that I have really enjoyed. So this could go either way, and I'll be honest as always. And afterward, I'll do the usual lyrical breakdown. We'll get into what the song is talking about. I'll give my perspective, my opinion. You know how it goes by now. But if you are new here, before we start, I need for you guys to hit that subscribe button to become part of the Nuclear family. And right after that, hit that bell for notifications. You will not regret it. All right, Custer by Slipknot. And thankfully, this has the lyrics in the description. Always super helpful. I'm not going to do the official video because I don't want to get blocked. That's always a struggle when you're a reaction channel, but you guys all know that by now. All right, let's check out Custer in 3, 2, 1, go.
I have this one.
Turn this up. That part right there, I remember. That's what I was thinking of. Is it just me, or does this remind me of something off of like their self-titled album? At least so far, we're only like 40 seconds in. But with like the turntables, the way that it's starting, the kind of, I don't know, it has a very new metal-y sort of feeling to it, which isn't a good or bad thing in my opinion yet. You know, my opinion is still developing, but it just made me think of their very first album from what I remember about it. But anyway, so far, it's interesting, so let's keep going.
Half alive and stark raving free and maligned for encroaching on the purpose of this commercial free interruption. Nature of this statement.
This is going to be an interesting one, isn't it?
As advised.
It strikes whenever I see a gun. I think about just how many you were, and it blows my fucking mind. Yeah, it blows my fucking mind. These days, I never seem to get enough. I'm tired of this shit. I want to go home. Don't waste my fucking time. Don't waste my fucking time. Because anything exceptional gets crushed by government people with jealousy and ignorance and all that government involves. I'm waiting for the punishment. I know it's not my way.
This one brings all the heaviness, man. Okay, so far I'm digging this, to my surprise. Like, It's not surprising that I like it, because as I've said before, I like many Slipknot songs. It's surprising on the level that I like it already. This is really, I like the aggression behind this, and I don't always like when Corey takes his vocals in a Slipknot direction. Like I've said on previous reactions, that I really like his melodic stuff. I like more of his Stone Sour work as opposed to his Slipknot songs. But in this one in particular, I like the direction that he's taking his angry sounding vocals. It just works for this song, at least so far. So it's very interesting. The only thing that I could do without is that one element that I did mention remembering, which is that kind of weird siren sound, that weird like ringing sound. I don't know what that is. I don't know why it's in this song, but I think that's like one of the reasons why I don't care for a lot of nu metal, because of those types of samples that they put in their songs. Very often to me, it feels very ill-fitting. It feels like it just kind of takes me out of the music. So I think that this song would have benefited from not having that element in it. But regardless of that, I still am enjoying the rest of this. So I can't wait to see where it goes from here. Let's continue.
Irreverence is my disease. It's secondhand for you to me. The son of a bitch is on his knees. The last man standing gets no pity.
You don't know what to expect from this song, and I like it.
Somewhere on a toilet wall, I read the words you form a line to form a line, to form a line that I find lies of the truth. Something so profound, and now it's sitting there, surrounded by the garbage and the stains. Another victim of the refuse. Now I've been saying this for years, but you don't come from
the build-up right here.
I fight hell and I fight fear because I understand it. Androgyny and insults.
The power of the percussion right here.
You
want
to win
really
the war.
Good. Yeah, I'm really enjoying this one, more so than some recent Slipknot songs I checked out a few months back on this channel. This one is like, I don't know, I haven't heard a lot about this song. I mean, once again, I've definitely heard the name many times. I had someone play it years ago, but it seems like this is maybe not one of their more popular songs. Correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, but I think this is like one of their underrated tracks for sure, if that's the case, because this one is, it has something going for it that kind of separates it from some other songs by Slipknot that I've heard recently. And I don't know what exactly it is, but I can speak to the power of the percussion in the song. The sheer impact of the drumming really gives a lot of heaviness to the song, and the song wouldn't be nearly as good without it. So I like how the drumming is used a lot. For whatever reason, you know, I talked about this on the last reaction too, my appreciation for drumming specifically is growing a lot more. I really have an ear for that now when I listen to metal. So yeah, I got to give credit for that. I really like, once again, the way Corey Taylor is using his voice. Very well put together so far. I'm digging it. Let's finish it up.
It's second hand, but you know me. The son of a bitch is on his knees. The last man standing gets no pity. Where the angel lies and demon sees. You're missing what you really need. When all is said and done, you see. The last man standing gets no pity.
Turn that heavy chorus once again. Let's bring it back one more time. That was a solid song from Slipknot. I really enjoyed that one. I liked the sheer heaviness that it had. I liked the beat very much. I liked the structure of it, the pattern. Yeah, it was just very good. I mean, it was heavy in all the right places. It was very catchy, but not in a cheesy kind of way. And I don't know, man. There's something about this overall that I think separates it, once again, for me, from some other Slipknot songs. And I really enjoyed this one. I would listen to this again. This is probably going to get the highest rating from me of any Slipknot song that I've reacted to on this channel, which is surprising even to me. But we have to think about the lyrics too. We're going to get to that in a minute. And based on the lyrics, I'll reassess what I think about this. But just based on the music, I'm really digging this a lot. You know what that ringing reminds me of? That siren sound in the song. There was this video, there was this channel called like Elders React. And they would have them listen to like all kinds of like funny shit, you know, music that they weren't familiar with. And one of the things they had them listen to was Elders React to Screaming Goats. And it was this meme where like they took popular songs by like artists like Adele and, you know, pop artists like that. And they would play the song and then they would interrupt the song every like, you know, a few seconds with like a screaming goat, you know, usually like screaming the chorus or whatever. It was completely ridiculous. Fucking stupid, but it was funny. And that's what that ringing sound reminded me of. It reminded me of that screaming goat. So just a sort of side tangent there, but that's kind of what I was thinking about toward the end. So once again, that did take me a little bit out of the music. It felt a little bit silly and unnecessary to me. Yeah, it just felt like it didn't really belong. I don't know what the purpose of that was. Maybe there was some greater significance to it. I honestly don't know. But I would have liked the song much better without that. And again, that speaks to how I really dislike the use of samples, unless they're really good and they really feel that they fit well. So that was a sample that I did not like. I also could have done without the turntables, especially toward the beginning. That's something that is very much still growing on me. And when I say growing, I mean growing very slowly, because I'm just not into that 9 times out of 10. So I could have done without that element of the music. That's, by the way, the main reason why I don't care for their self-titled album that much, even today. Although I can certainly respect it and can respect the talent behind it and why it's such a classic album. But yeah, I would have left that out. I would have left out that sample and kept everything else, because everything else was really damn good. So I definitely will listen to this again. This might be the first Slipknot song to make it onto a playlist for me, which is saying something. And yeah, maybe I gotta react to them more often. Maybe there are other hidden gems like this that I'm just missing out on. So really good music, aside from my couple of criticisms. That's what I think about that. Now let's get to the lyrics and see what we're talking about. I have some idea already because it was a lyric video, but let's see anyway. Rise, half alive and stark raving, free and maligned, encroaching on the purpose of this commercial-free interruption due to the prolific nature of the statement. Listener aggression is advised. Love that. Love that tongue-in-cheek kind of writing that Corey has. It's strange, whenever I see a gun, I think about just how petty you are, and it blows my fucking mind. Also beautifully written. These days, I never seem to get enough. I'm tired of this shit. I want to go home. Don't waste my fucking time. Because anything exceptional gets crushed by common people, with jealousy and ignorance, and all their common evils. This planet isn't special. Collection's made of clay. I'm waiting for the punishment I know is on my way. So cut, cut, cut me up and fuck, fuck, fuck me up. Irreverence is my disease. It's secondhand, but you know me. The son of a bitch is on his knees. The last man standing gets no pity. Somewhere on a toilet wall, I read the words, you form a line to formalize the former lies. The wordplay there is just brilliant. I'm going to get back to that when I get to the breakdown. But let's keep going. And I finally saw the truth, something so profound, and it was sitting there, surrounded by the garbage and the stains, another victim of the refuse. Now I've been saying this for years, but you don't comprehend it. I fight hell and I fight fear because I understand it. Androgyny and insults, you try so hard to be difficult. You want to win the war and know what you're fighting for. And then the final verse, with angel eyes and demon seeds, you're missing what you really need. When all is said and done, you see, the last man standing gets no pity. This, I was already sort of developing what this could be about as I was listening to the song, although it was kind of hard because I was really appreciating the music. But this could have one of two meanings. I think it could be about someone who feels pushed to the margins and is just fed up with everything. Or it could be about how individuality is stamped out and oppressed. Or actually, I apologize for the ice cube munching. Actually, it could be somewhere in between. And that song title, Custer, I'm not sure on the meaning, but I think that may have been an older word meaning someone who was cowardly, someone who just readily gives in and blindly accepts anything. I'm not sure, but I think that may be derived from the Middle English custume, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, from which we get words like customary. You know, something that's done or accepted because it's seen as normal. So I think this song is really Corey railing against the ignorance of commonality and blind conformity. And it's something that never gets old and never gets irrelevant. And I mean, it only takes one look at most people to see why. So I think this song could very much be about being opposed to or against whoever this Custer is, and being the individual and the exception rather than one of the herd. A common theme in metal, but once again, very necessary. It just never loses relevance. Because it says here, and I really like this verse, anything exceptional gets crushed by common people with jealousy and ignorance and all their common evils. All their common evils. This is probably among Corey's most well-written songs out of the ones that I've reacted to, in addition to how much I like the music. And I think that when we juxtapose this message with what's going on in reality, I think we live in an interesting time. Because there seems to be more individuality in terms of self-expression and subculture, but at the same time, more blindness and collective obedience than ever before when it comes to thoughts and beliefs. And we see that in one area, you know, I think people know what I'm probably getting at here, you know, one area in which people push themselves to one side or the other, you know, and everyone has to be in one of two extreme and opposite camps of thought and ideology. And whenever you're somewhere in between and you think for yourself, people get up in arms and, you know, the torches and the pitchforks come out. Which, you know, mostly happens online because people are too chicken shit to be that confrontational face to face. But still, there you have it, you know. So I think it's a very strange status quo in which you've got sheep in all different shapes and styles and colors, but they're still sheep at the end of the day. And they're hazily wandering on the way to the same slaughterhouse. Yeah, and I think that today, you know, this is maybe, you know, controversial to discuss in a video, but I think that today, especially with, you know, the online kangaroo courts and cancel culture, people who don't think for themselves and are just, you know, bitter and resentful and filled with hatred for people who choose to stand taller, choose to do more, it's become very easy for those people to take their own mediocrity and weaponize it, right? Usually against someone who has fought harder than them, put in more work, has been more passionate and more ambitious. And Corey is exactly that kind of talented artist. And I'm sure this song is probably based off some personal experiences that he's had. Maybe on tour, maybe with, you know, fans, maybe with other band members, who knows? You know, maybe with the music industry in general. And so when we go back to that verse, anything exceptional gets crushed by common people. I think that becomes even more powerful when you have that real social context within which to view it. So Corey, like any metal artist, deals with his share of slander and libel and bullshit thrown at him by, you know, for lack of a better term, by the peanut gallery. And the way I see it, this song is an example of him not only calling that out, but using it to underscore the nature of collective obedience versus independent free thought. So this is really a think about it kind of song. And so I really think that he's talking about himself when he says, something so profound, and it was sitting there, surrounded by the garbage and the stains, another victim of the refuse. So again, I think that he's very much contrasting himself with people who are ingrates, people who don't think for themselves, who just adhere loyally to the status quo, without using any real free thinking or rational thought. And he's basically taking a look around, and he's removing himself from that situation. And that's something I had to do a few years back, so I totally get that. And these lines here, I really like. You try so hard to be different. You want to win the war and know what you're fighting for. If that doesn't take a dig at, like, outrage culture and virtue signaling, I don't know what does. It's this online yapping, you know? It's this empty, over-emotional noise that you get from people. And people who are just frustrated and disenfranchised and they want something to be angry at. And 90% of the time, they don't have a full and developed understanding of what they're talking about. And I could get into specifics. There are some very specific things, especially lately, that I could touch upon as examples. But I don't want to be that controversial. I'm not looking to stir people up. I'm just looking to make people think a little bit more for themselves, which I think Corey, with this song, is also looking for. So I'll leave it there, but you know, instead of taking responsibility for themselves, they want to tear down other people. It's like typical toxic behavior. So that's where I think this song is going. As always, it could be wrong, and If you have a different interpretation, let me know in the comments. I always appreciate reading your thoughts. Never be afraid to leave a comment below. But this really seems to be taking aim at the common collective, the people who march along through the maze unquestioningly and ignorantly. But more than just the meaning, the whole way this is written is just artistic, you know? That's really it. Like, Corey has impressed me with his lyrics before, but this, I think, is number one for me. Just the way that he arranges lines and uses wordplay. Like, even the opening lines. It's strange, whenever I see a gun, I think about just how petty you are, and it blows my fucking mind. I love the ironic wordplay there. It's really clever, and more than that, it says something of substance. And then, here where it says, I read the words, you form a line to formalize the former lies. That, I think, is just brilliantly put together. And I seriously think that Corey Taylor doesn't get nearly enough credit for his lyricism. Like, he gets so much credit for his vocals, and very much well-deserved, of course. But when it comes to his lyrical writing, people need to notice that, I think, and pick up on that a little bit more. And probably Slipknot fans already do. But it would be cool if some outsiders noticed it a little bit more, too. And so, before I digress, that line, what I think it means is people believe in a lie that they're told, whether it's by other people, by people in power, by social media, by marketing, by religion, whatever it may be. And then based upon that belief, they get in line with what they're told to do and who they're told to be. And they happily accept their shackles and make it the new status quo. And in doing so, they're formalizing the former lies, which to them have now become a singular truth to which they're beholden. And when anything intervenes that attempts to shatter that truth, they lash out emotionally because they just can't accept the possibility of their own blindness. And finally, when he says here, the main chorus, cut me up, fuck me up, I think he's saying, what I think he's trying to convey with that is that he's the scapegoat. He's the effigy that people burn in their own opposition to their mental liberation and in their own opposition toward their self-respect. And he's saying, okay, fine, I'll be that. That's my role as an artist, to shake things up and to take the hits and to keep coming back. And in saying this, he hammers the final nail in the coffin against the sheep mentality that this Custer, I think, represents. So this, to me, is a declaration of personal independence and an anthem against being mentally enslaved by what we're told to be and told to do. And in that way, if that's what it is saying, I think it does a great job at it. Once again, great writing here from Corey. I think it's the best example I've seen so far of his writing, and probably my favorite Slipknot song in the lyrics department, and probably one of my favorites when it comes to the music. Although, once again, it does leave something to be desired, slightly, because there were a few things that I would change about it. But overall, it was pretty damn good. I was more or less impressed by the music, but even more than that, really impressed by the writing here and what the song had to say. So that's pretty much what I think about it. You know, I was thinking as I heard this that I was going to give this a very strong 10 out of 12 when it comes to the rating. But after taking the lyrics into account and really thinking about the song in its entirety, I'm going to give this one an 11 out of 12 on the Doomsday Clock. So that's pretty much it. My breakdown, my review, my rating. If you made it this long, thank you. I know my videos tend to run longer. That's because it's a full immersive experience. That's just what Nuclear Reactions is all about. I like to give you guys a full range of everything. The reaction, the review, my own opinion. And if you like that, if you support that, I really appreciate you. Once again, if you're new here, hit that subscribe button. Don't forget to hit that bell. Check out patreon.com/nuclearreactions. There is much more good content on the way, including Patreon requests, new releases, me reacting to other genres outside of metal, more popular songs, more underground songs, a little bit of everything. You're going to get a lot of variety. So look forward to that. And in the meantime, have a great holiday if you celebrate it. If not, have a great weekend. Much love and respect to the Nuclear family, and I will catch you all on the next one. Something so profound and now it's